dusted a...
In January 1956, Elvis Presley appeared on national television for the very first time, and within a few months, America was obsessed with rock and roll. Teenagers were entranced, but their parents were appalled, not only by Presley's music, but also by his performance, which they saw as lewd and suggestive.
He was asked by one of the interviewers, when are you going to get married and have kids, settle down like Pat Boone? Because we were nip and tuck in all the popularity polls then. And he sort of leered at the camera. He says, why should I buy a cow when I can get milk through the fence? Well, that sent shockwaves around the world. See, parents say, see, that's why you can't buy that boy's records.
Most adults assume that Presley was a flash in the pan, but rock and roll really was here to stay. Elvis would go on to transform popular music, becoming one of the century's most celebrated pop icons.
To me, Elvis changed the world because he came and on a silver salver gave the world the gift of black music.
Presley's gift was in fact even greater. What he really offered was an intoxicating blend of two forms of music, one black but the other white, which had flourished for more than 50 years in the part of America dearest to his heart. Elvis Presley came from the South, that vast stretch of America which starts in the mountains of Kentucky and Virginia, embraces the southern states that line the banks of the mighty Mississippi River, and ends more than 1,000 miles away on the western border of Texas. The cross-pollination of black and white popular music took place throughout the United States, but nowhere was it more potent than in the South. There, the great ethnic diversity ensured that the musical melting pot was especially rich.
It was like, in Kentucky, they have a wonderful type of food that they cook called burgoo. And burgoo is a great big stew in which you put in whatever you've got handy. The music in the South was a burgoo. It was a little of everything.
One of the principal ingredients in the South's musical stew from which rock and roll would one day emerge was the down-home music making practiced by the so-called hillbillies who lived in the rural areas of Kentucky, Virginia, and Tennessee. For them, playing and singing was part of everyday life.
It wasn't nothing that mommy or daddy, either one, couldn't pick up and play, you know. They could play a saw, they could play a washboard. I mean, they used a doggone tub as a drum. So there wasn't nothing they couldn't do, play like that.
As well as fiddle tunes brought over from Britain and Ireland, the mountain folk had a rich legacy of songs to draw on. And if they couldn't think of an old song that said what they wanted to say, they'd make up a new one that did.
In the hills, if anything happened, Mommy would write a song about it. And then she would learn it to me, and I'd sing it as I was rocking the babies to sleep. I'd get out on the front porch in the swing, and I'd sing to the top of my voice, and Daddy would come out on the porch and say, Lordy, People all over this holler can hear you. And I'd say, Daddy, there ain't that many people up here. So what difference does it make?
A woman using my instrument to watch you.
Well, can you imagine that?
Well, what you gonna play?
Tomorrow.
While white Southerners like Loretta Lynn's family were refining their musical style, the rural black population of states like Georgia and Mississippi were doing the same.
Oh, Mary, don't you weep, don't you moan. Oh, Mary, don't you weep, don't you moan. Pharaoh's army got drowned. Oh, Mary, don't weep. Oh, Mary, don't you weep, don't you moan.
Music was one of the few diversions available to those working the cotton fields. Out of the plantations came the work song and field hollers, and out of the European hymn evolved the spiritual. The religious and the secular gradually came together to form the type of music known today as the blues. Filmed, songs like Death Letter Blues were rarely heard outside the Mississippi Delta, where Son House and many other blues men grew up. Yet they would still manage to exert a strong influence on mainstream pop. The interaction between blues and popular music began in the very early years of the century. One summer day, a classically trained band leader called W.C. Handy was waiting for a train in a small Delta town, and a man he later described as a lean, loose-jointed Negro sat down beside him and started to play the blues.
I believe I buy me a graveyard of my own.
Handy thought it was the strangest music he had ever heard, but then he heard it again a few months later in a dance hall where his band had been booked to appear. This time he took more notice.
During an intermission, the sponsor of the dance asked if Handy would mind if a local string trio of black musicians played a few numbers, some of their native music, as Handy described it. And Handy said, sure, we don't mind at all. They played blues or something very much like it, and the crowd went wild. They showered this band with more money in tips than Handy's band of trained musicians were paid for the entire evening. And Handy wrote in his autobiography many years later, right there I saw the beauty of primitive music.
St. Louis Blues would become the most recorded song in American history and represents a clear turning point in the whole development of popular song.
Is the song that brought blues into the American lexicon. There were other songs with blues in the title, but that's the one people heard That was the hit. It was also the first instance of that standard blues where you see the repetition. I hate to see the evening sun go down. I hate to see the evening sun go down, because then, you know, my man's done left this town. That the two repeated stanzas and then the third rhyming stanza. That is the blues form as we know it in this country.
During the 1920s, the blues crossed over into popular music. The jazz-flavored singing that became known as classic blues was dominated by women performers, usually from a vaudeville background. The greatest of them all was Bessie Smith.
There's something about her that's completely magic. She's called the Empress of the Blues for every good reason. She was majestic. She had an extraordinary innate ability to ornament, to break notes into four bits if necessary. At the same time, she had tremendous taste when it came to leaving spaces or making a very simple statement. In the South, of course, they thought of her as one of them. When she sang about the way men treated her, the women completely went with her. He used to shout hallelujah and tell them like it is.
Sales of the newly invented phonograph took off during the early 1920s. Bessie Smith became an important recording artist. Her 1923 recording, Downhearted Blues, sold a million copies. Her success led record companies to scout for more talent. The music they brought back from the South was much rawer country blues. Almost certainly the very same music which W.C. Handy had stumbled across years before. Many record buyers were drawn to this from the late 20s onwards. Among them a shy country boy who would one day be known as B.B. King.
My mother was very religious, so she didn't have records in the house. But I had a great aunt, my mother's aunt, that was sort of like teenagers are today, and she bought records. And when I was a good boy, she'd let me play her Victrola. You'd wind it up and put one of those big, thick 78 records on it and play it. She had kind of a variety, but the two that I picked mostly were Lonnie Johnson and Blind Lemon Jefferson.
I ain't got no mama now. Got no mama now.
A certain way that they sing and the way the sound of their guitars were, it was sort of like a sword that went straight through me.
You see, it's just a matter of how you play it. Does it have the intensity? Does it make any sense to anybody else? Does it get to you? And the blues is a very, very pointed, very sharp stick, you know, in the eye.
I mean, when you stop to think about it, the blues, blues ain't got but three chords. You know what I mean? The whole thing, the whole song ain't got but three chords. So simplicity is, of course, the key to most things. You know, you find something very simple, you know, people can identify with it, they can appreciate it.
If you're a musician, it's a fascinating form of music to play. Because inside those parameters, you realize you're still learning every day, you know? It's a beautifully flexible music for such a limited form. Yeah.
And carry to the captain.
The most successful black performer to emerge from the South in the years between the wars was not strictly a blues singer, but a self-styled songster from Louisiana whose real name was Huddy Leadbetter, much better known as Leadbelly.
You tell him I was crying. You tell him I was crying.
Leadbelly had a great influence on me. I don't think he was a blues singer. I think he was more of a folk singer. And it was very, you know, it was broad-ranging from blues, jazz songs, show tunes. He had a very broad repertoire, Leadbelly.
Good Night Irene, which was Leadbelly's most famous song, was actually written back in the 19th century by a black composer named Gussie Davis and published in sheet music. Leadbelly didn't get it from the sheet music. He learned it probably indirectly from one of the touring vaudeville groups that came through Texas. But the point is, he didn't really care about where the song came from. If it was a good song, it was a good song.
One sunny morning, Lord, 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 the preacher went a-hunting. Lord, 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 he carried along the shotgun. Lord, 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 don't come and break you. Lord, 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 the gun went off the balloon. Lord, 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 don't come and break you.
Leadbelly made a name for himself as a concert performer in the late 1930s. But neither he nor any other black southerner had the same level of success their white counterparts enjoyed around the same time.
Hopefuls are lining up to kiss.
Hillbilly, as the music of all white southerners was originally known, began to appear on record as early as 1923. And by the end of the decade, the genre had found its first true star, a former railroad worker called Jimmy Rogers.
All around the water tanks, waiting for a train, 1,000 miles away from home, sleeping in the rain.
He resembled the 50s rockers in several important respects, not least the scale of his success.
Several of his records sold 1 million copies, and that was in a time when it was just almost unheard of. Al Jolson didn't sell that many copies of a single record in those days. Bing Crosby didn't have 1 million seller until the late 1930s, and he'd been recording, actually began a year before Jimmy Rogers. Babies were named after him. Cigars were named after him. He was bigger than Elvis Presley.
Oh, you want, well, what about my coffee back there?
I'll have it ready shortly.
Rogers' appeal right. came in I'll part from his famous blue yodel.
Yes, that's it.
All right.
That gal that made a wreck out of me. The old lady, old lady, old lady. If you don't want me, woman, you sure don't have to stall.
Rogers' yodel gave songs like Tea for Texas a very distinctive sound, but what makes them historically important is that they are an early form of white blues.
Than a passenger train can haul. I'm gonna buy
To me, there was no difference. There's white blues and there's black blues. Those country boys are damn good blues pickers too. You know, I mean, it's not relegated or particularly just to one segment of the population in America.
He knew black people from the time he was just, you know, a small child. And he very much admired them and their music, but he took it and became a kind of catalyst for something that was not quite the same as what he had heard. He stamped it with his own unique mark somehow.
Jimmy Rogers was hugely affected by blues, but music isn't the property of any one class or any one race or any one person. And Jimmy Rogers absorbed so many different influences without affectation. His music continues to have impact to this day.
Jimmy Rogers died in 1933, but hillbilly, or country music as it was now starting to be called, continued to thrive thanks in part to the huge success of a certain radio show.
The only night I got to stay up on past 9 o'clock was Saturday night. My mom would always let me stay up because she knew I loved the Grand Ole Opry.
We've got about 4,000 of our friends out here in the Opry House tonight. We hope we've got millions more listening in.
First broadcast in 1925, the Grand Ole Opry was a Southern institution long before it started going out live every Saturday night from the Ryman Auditorium in Nashville, Tennessee.
It's in the Ryman that the Opry won the reputation that it has today. And so people today still rightfully look upon the Ryman as the mother church of country music.
When I walk on that stage there, I feel that I'm where the old greats were, and that's the ones that matters. It's the ones you follow that matters. It's not the ones that come after you, it's the ones you follow.
Taken up by radio stations all over America, the Grand Ole Opry made stars of many Southern performers, like Roy Acuff.
From the great Atlantic Ocean to the wide Pacific shore, from the queen of flowing mountains to the South Bell by the shore, she's mighty tall and handsome and known well by all. She's the combination on the Wabash Cannonball.
The Wabash Cannonball, contrary to what a lot of people think, was not written by Acuff, nor was it an old folk song. It was actually a piece of sheet music that was written about the turn of the century by a man named William Kent. And it was about a train that, in fact, did run up in Indiana. And like a lot of early country songs, the sheet music somehow got loose in the countryside. Somebody learned it from sheet music, and then they taught it orally to somebody else, and orally to somebody else, and pretty soon what was once a piece of Tin Pan Alley fodder became a folk song.
You're traveling through the jungles on the Wabash Cannonball.
Roy Acuff's folksy style was so popular during the Second World War that he beat Frank Sinatra and Bing Crosby in a popularity poll among American GIs. But after the war, country music underwent a radical change. The down-on-the-farm sound of Acuff gave way to a much tougher style. Generally referred to as honky-tonk music, this new brand of country featured electric guitars, a heavy backbeat, and lyrics that were notable for their cynical tone.
The country music audience was no longer the audience of mom and pop and kids sitting on the farm, sucking on straw and eating apples. They were now working in the cities, they were living in trailer parks, they were dealing with divorce, they were dealing with alcoholism, and as a result,
you get the honky-tonk sound of songs like Driving Nails in My Coffin, Headed Down the Wrong Highway. It wasn't God who made honky-tonk angels. These songs were songs that dealt with real problems. And so by the time Elvis Presley comes on the scene in 1956, some of the subjects that he's talking about weren't all that revolutionary. The country audience had been there already.
Honky Tonk dominated country music throughout the 40s and 50s, and is still popular today. Its biggest star and the man who would take country to a wider audience was Hank Williams. Hank Williams lived the rock and roll lifestyle before the world had even heard of rock and roll. Today, he's widely regarded as one of the greatest songwriters popular music has ever produced.
He had an emotion in his voice that sold whatever he was singing, whatever he was doing, that people could connect with. He could do Your Cheating Heart, I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry, and he could do My Bucket's Got a Hole in It, and whatever mood or emotion he was conveying, he could hear it in his voice.
Someone who spotted his ability very early on was steel guitarist Don Helms, a key member of Williams' backing band, the Drifting Cowboys. Helms was convinced that Williams was going to be a big, big star from the moment he started playing with him in 1945.
I'd played a lot of honky-tonks, but I noticed that when we'd play them with Hank, a lot of people wouldn't dance. They'd come up and stand in front of the stage and watch him. There was just something about him that fascinated people, and I observed that. I said, I don't know.
Everyday living, and I think that's probably what made him such a great artist.
He wrote "Hey Good Looking" on a Sunday morning. We were on our way from Nashville to Birmingham to play a matinee, and he wrote that in the back seat of the car, just on a napkin or something. He was very clever at knowing what people like to hear, and he was equally clever in putting it on paper. He started writing songs about the guy that worked at the mill all day, and he'd get off from work and stop at the bar and have a cool one on the way home, and get in trouble with his wife. She'd make him sleep in the doghouse, and people related to that. I mean, he was singing their song.
If Southern whites like Hank Williams helped lay the foundations for rock and roll, so too did Southern blacks. Black servicemen returning from the war were less prepared to put up with the ways of the Old South. Attitudes and music were on the move.
They had seen something of the world. They had risked their lives for America, and they were not content to go back to the plantations and be called boy and be discriminated against. Many of them, after a year or two, packed up and headed for the cities, and that changed the sound of the blues.
Like jazz musicians 20 years earlier, bluesmen made a beeline for Chicago. And once they got there, the music they had brought with them from the cotton fields assumed a very different form.
It acquired a more in-your-face quality. It was more aggressive, and I think it spoke to the greater confidence in the black community, the sense of progress and forward.
Rolling Stone, which is basically just Muddy alone doing the kind of music with which he had grown up in Mississippi, but with an amplified guitar rather than an acoustic one. And I think those are performances just of astonishing power.
What Muddy did was crucial in those early recordings, finding out how to do it, how the rhythm should play. Do you need a backup guitar? The early ones are just, as you know, just piano, bass, guitar, and add the instruments one by one. Does the sax fit in? Where does the harmonica fit in?
Everybody knows.
It always takes the one creative individual who has to do it. And Chicago had Muddy Waters.
Really, I guess, impressed me is the blues, the electric blues bands of the 50s, the Chicago blues bands, the way that they welded it all together. Took it out of the country, brought it to the city, and then sent it back out again.
I'm gonna mess with you. I'm gonna make you good. Leave me by my hand. Then the world will know.
Muddy Waters' electric blues wasn't the only form of post-war black music that fed into rock and roll. Just as influential as the Chicago sound was the much smoother style of another Southern musician, Louis Jordan, who blended blues with swing.
Hey, boy, what you doing, man? Cut it. Hey, what you gonna do? That ain't the piece we supposed to play. Come on. Well, I guess I better get on in here with it. Walking with my baby, she got great big feet. She's long, lean, and lanky, and ain't had nothing to eat. But she's my baby, and I love her just the same. Crazy about that woman, 'cause Caledonia is her name.
Louis Jordan came out of a great big, a fabulous swing band, Chick Webb Swing Band, and he diverged from what Chick Webb was doing and started doing these good time shuffles with a lot of humor in them and a lot of drive and a lot of backbeat. And what it really was good time Saturday night partying music.
Caledonia! Caledonia! What make your big head so hard? Mouth! I love you just the same.
Oh, how we loved Louis Jordan. The music was so good. He had a wonderful sense of what there was to find within the whole world of black music. He was always looking more. And he respected his audience. He respected the music he was playing. And he was wonderful.
Who's the greatest band around? Makes the cats jump up and down. Who's the talk of Rhythm Town? Five guys named Mo. When they start to beat it out, everybody jump and shout. Tell me, who do the critics rave about? Five guys named Mo.
Louis Jordan's records were brought in large numbers by whites as well as blacks, giving him what was known as crossover success. And where he led, others followed.
Hey, here's some goodies. Put them on, bud.
All right.
As the 40s turned into the 50s, many black artists found themselves appealing to young whites thanks partly to a communications revolution.
Hearing a new kind of music, and this was in such contrast to Patti Page and Perry Como. It was like switching from a diet of chocolate fudge sundaes to chili dogs and hamburgers. There was relish, there was savor, and it just turned them on. And of course, not only the sound of the music or the lyrics, but also the propulsive dance beat.
And in that dance beat was a sexual energy, sometimes reinforced by ambiguous and suggestive lyrics.
You women have heard of jalopies, you've heard the noise they make, but let me introduce my new Rocket 88.
A guy would sing a song, let me play with your poodle, let me play with your poodle, your little poodle dog. But you know he was not talking about a poodle. You understand what I mean? See, it had two meanings. It give you the idea, you know. I want to be your chauffeur. I want to drive you down. So, you know, all these songs, they said it, but it said it nice. That you didn't, you know, it was nothing to irritate you. You knew what it meant if your mind went there. But if it didn't go there, it could go to the version of what the song was actually saying. And it still worked.
As black record sales began to take off, the music industry decided to change the classification, which up to then had been race music.
I've always thought it was the most honorable designation, because I can remember back in the 30s when one black person would say of another one, he's a race man to the bricks, meaning from the top of his head to the ground, he's a promulgator, a proud promulgator of negritude. But somehow down the line, race seemed to imply separation, inferiority. And so we just changed it to rhythm and blues.
Somebody white, somebody white called it rhythm and blues, which was just a faster tempo of the slowest blues. Like what they're playing now. You got slow blues. Dun, 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 dun. Dun, 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 dun. Slow blues. Now that's blues. Now you wouldn't call that rhythm and blues. And then you say, rhythm and blues.
The weather outside.
Hey, Joe! Hey, Big Joe Turner, come on in.
Nobody sang rhythm and blues better than Big Joe Turner, a great blues shouter who'd spent 20 years singing with jazz bands.
Let him rock a while. Great. Get out of that kitchen, baby, wash your face and hey.
Joe Turner had the most unusual voice of any blues singer that I can think of. A beautiful baritone rolling out like an opera singer was coming from his belly. So it was just natural. It came from that huge belly and diaphragm.
Baby, roll my eyes, baby, baby, grit my teeth. I'll let shake, rattle and roll. Shake, rattle and roll. Shake.
Jerry Wexler's company, Atlantic Records, scored several hits with Big Joe Turner, But like all labels that specialized in black performers, they were badly hit by what was then a common music industry practice.
What would happen in those days, not just with Joe Turner, but with many of our artists, such as Laverne Baker, Ruth Brown, the big pop record companies would take our records and white bread them, vanilla them, and to make them palatable for the white audiences.
Nobody expected an original R&B record to get played on pop radio because it was too unfinished sounding. You couldn't understand the words. It was just alien to our ears, but you could do a pop version of that song and perhaps have a hit.
Get out in that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans. Get out in that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans. Where are my breakfast? 'Cause I'm a hungry man. I said, shake, rattle and
roll. Bill Haley was on Decca, and Decca didn't feature themselves promoting songs with lines like, when you wear those dresses and the sun comes shining through, I can't believe my eyes, all that mess belongs to you, which were the honest blues lines. And they cleaned it up for Bill Haley, who of course had enormous success with the cover.
Haley's record was one of the first to be labeled rock and roll, but a more unlikely figurehead for a musical revolution would have been very hard to find.
Bill was attempting to be a country western band. It was called the Saddle Tramps, and he didn't do very well with that, so he decided that he would try to do the blues, but in a Saddle Tramp style. So that's how Bill created rock and roll.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight.
Bill had touched something that he didn't quite understand. And he didn't really ever know quite what to do about it. But as he said, no matter what happened, he always knew at the end of the show, he'd sing Rock Around the Clock, and everyone would love it, and he'd feel real good.
While Bill Haley was still reeling from his first taste of fame, the man who would soon replace him as the king of rock and roll released his debut single.
A shoebox. It's so tiny. And then yet when you hear those Sun recordings, they have this acoustic space that seems like the Grand Canyon. It seems huge. Sam Phillips saw what he could do with slapback bass and echo, that he could create this sense of space and dimension to sound, which was not something that could be done live.
Phillips had set up Sun Studios to record local blues artists, which he'd done with some success. But he knew that if the music was to reach a wider audience, he would have to find, in his words, a white man who had the Negro sound and, more importantly, the Negro feel.
With this blues, Sam Phillips was not even aware that he even knew a song like this. And at that moment, it snapped into place for Sam Phillips. That's it. That's what we want.
Sam had no idea what he was looking for, but damn, I'm sure glad he knew when he found it. And played it back to us. He said, man, that's great, you know. So yeah, sounds good. What is it? You know, because it's just stuff we just made up on the spot, the rhythm, style, and everything. Blue.
claim to greatness.
Play that for someone who's never heard it, and it's like, who is that? You know, and you tell them who it is, and they're amazed. There's such power in those records.
Within a few years of those Memphis recordings, Elvis had gone from being an obscure hillbilly singer to the most famous performer in the world. His rise was a clear sign that popular music had taken a decisive turn and entered a major new phase.
Back in the big band days when you had people like Bing Crosby and Frank Sinatra, they were singing up there, they were cardboard cutouts, you know, right in front of the microphone. This body of mine, that's to have that girl. But Elvis Presley is a supreme showman. He is very much like Hank Williams or Lead Belly performers who move around and really sell the song. And that's one of the great changes that occurred between formal popular music, the European tradition, and the new tradition of the American South. Mm-hmm. Hey, hey, I'm all shook up.